I'm Katie Weaver, the 2021 GMAR President, and on behalf of GMAR, the Diversity and Inclusion Committee, and the WCR Networks, we want to thank you for joining us for this Equity and Inclusion Conference. We're so excited to have over 300 people joining us today, and we have an incredible lineup of speakers, and all set up for you, and we hope that you are ready to take notes. There's going to be a lot of information. As we begin, I want to say a huge thank you to the Women's Council of Realtors Networks for partnering with us on this event. And another thank you to the local businesses that have donated some really exciting prizes for you today. We can't see who the winners are. Most of us are very familiar with the virtual conferences by now, but let's cover a little bit of housekeeping. So there's a chat box on the right of your screen where you can submit questions. GMAR staff will be tracking your submissions and we will get to them during the Q&A after we've heard from our incredible speakers. Thank you in advance for your thoughtful questions and we will try to address as many as we can as time allows. We did a random drawing right before the conference for each of the prizes today. Please drop a note in the chat to indicate that if you are present and if you hear your name called. If the winner named is not present in the conference, we will draw another name for that prize. After the conference is done, there will be a survey available on the event page, and it'll also be emailed to you. You must complete the survey if you want CE credits for today. We will be able to tell who attends the full conference, and only those who attend the entire conference and submit their survey will be qualified for the one legal and the two general credits. Now let's begin. The theme of the event is to move from awareness to action. We are here to learn the ways that we can, as individuals, we can be better practitioners, advocates, and supporters for the most inclusive fair housing practices in our industry. To get us started, I would like to welcome our moderator and first speaker, Robert Morris. Robert is an international speaker and teacher, among so many other things, and he is here to share with us the secrets to embracing equality and inclusion. Please welcome my dear friend, Robert Morris.
Wow. Well, thank you so much, Madam President. It is quite an honor to be back with you and your illustrious group of real estate professionals in the great state of Michigan. I know it's going to be an exciting and rewarding day today, so I'm excited about the opportunity to speak with your group and to present our wonderful group of speakers that we'll have afterwards. So thank you all for the opportunity to be with you today, allowing you me to share a few thoughts with you guys about embracing diversity, equity, and inclusion. Now, here's the deal. After the session, we're going to make a challenge to commit ourselves to change, to do the things differently, and make a positive difference. That is a challenge that I issue to each and every one of you. And here's what I hope will happen, that you'll be up for the challenge with me too. So let's get started. Let me talk to you about a few things. You see, we're in a very challenging time right now, dealing with the pandemic, the major health crisis that we're in. We have serious financial stress and rising racial tensions, as we all have become aware of. We're doing all of that while we're trying to exist and create a new normal, or even just to get back to some kind of old normal that we may have had before. So with that in mind, let me share a couple of pieces with you. You see, in order for us to adjust and to acclimate ourselves to what this new normal is, our new way of life, there are some things that we ourselves must do. So the first thing we need to do is to adapt to a new way of doing business and nurturing our personal relationships. That's going to be critically important. The second thing that we need to do is that we need to embrace new opportunities to create better communications with one another. Right now, we've been able to do Skype, and we've been able to do Zoom. We've got all of these WebEx. We've got all of these pieces. I don't ever think that they're going to go away. All right. They are probably here to stay. As a matter of fact, they were here already. We just didn't use them as much because we were not forced to use those. So hopefully we'll get back to an old way of normal with some new components in it. And the third thing that we need to do is that we need to develop and design business practices that will survive this crisis and carry us on into the future as we actually grow our real estate careers. And in doing so, those are the things that will help us adapt to what this new normal is. What else can I tell you? Well, I want you to know this about all of this equity and inclusion thing, because I just wrote an article about it. People go like, well, what's to this diversity, equity, and inclusion thing anyway? Well, here's the first thing I want you to know. Acknowledging people and cultures is not necessarily about being politically correct, but it's really about becoming aware of the changing demographics of the real estate consumer and of our country as a whole. And there are changes that are going on that we have to recognize in our country. What else? Well, I would say to you then that what it means to embrace diversity by definition. So here's a definition of diversity for you, so I could share it with you. To consider all people as unique and recognize, understand, and appreciate their individual differences. That's what it means to embrace diversity. Because I will tell you, all of us are unique individuals. No one of us is actually exactly the same. Our backgrounds are different. Our cultures, our orientations are different. Maybe our national origins are different. Even if we look the same, there are a huge amount of differences that exist among us. So we want to just kind of share a couple of pieces with you on that. Social inclusion. That is the process of improving the terms of participation in any society, particularly for people who are disadvantaged, through enhancing opportunities, accessing the resources, the voice, and the respect for rights of people. So when we talk about social inclusion, how do we create a process whereby there is more participation from everybody in our society? That is what the I is all about. And then I'll share with you the diversity, equity, inclusion piece that we talk about. I want you to know it does not mean that someone wins and someone else loses. We always have a win-lose proposition when we start to put things out. Which side of the table are you on? Which team are you on? I would just say to all of you all, we on the human team, right? Because we're all kind of made up the same way. So it doesn't mean if you have diversity, equity, and inclusion that someone wins and someone else loses. What it does, it presents an opportunity for everybody to benefit, for everybody to have more, to do more, to be more in any particular society. That's why we talk about diversity, equity, inclusion. Let me tell you a couple other pieces then. Well, when we go through, one of the biggest influences that we have on us as individuals is the culture where we come from. So now let me explain that to you this way. Culture consists of values, beliefs, systems of language, the communications, and the practices that people share in common that can be used to define them as the collective. For example, you want to say, well, you know, you guys are in Michigan. Do you know that there are things that are said about people who live in the North? You know, they all do that because there's this perception, particularly from a Southerner, that the Northerners do something a little bit different. But, you know, the people out West in California, you know, they're a strange breed because they do that kind of stuff. You know, they all do that. But when we talk about culture, it depends on the people who've influenced us. It depends on the people who have had some input into our lives, our coaches, our teachers, our parents, our uncles and aunts, our pastor or priest, or those people that we believed in, those people that taught us things as we were growing up through our formative years, they had input in our lives. So therefore, we think a lot based on what our culture was. How do we do a certain thing? Why do we like this and not that? Why do we prepare food this way and not another way? So those are things that come from our culture. And we are a big conglomerate of what our culture is. What else can I tell you? Culture impacts how we think and feel. It impacts how we see the values and how we look at the world. Furthermore, it says that this next one says, culture has a tremendous impact on our biases and on our prejudices. How do we feel about someone, or how do we feel about a particular position? If you were raised on a farm and you used your hands, you were taught that hard work involved your hands. So you may reluctantly look at an individual who just works as a computer programmer in a different light because their hands, they use them, but they're not using them in the same fashion that the farmer had to use their hands. So consequently, you may have formed some bias that says, if you don't have rough hands, you really don't work. Now, where did that come from? It came from our culture. It came from our orientation of what we were involved in. What else can I tell you? Well, when we look at these pieces, let me deal with my story real quick because we're moving real quick. Just keep going down. I'm an only child. What else can I tell you? My dad was self-employed. My mom, she has a master's degree. She taught school and then she went back at the young age of 68 to get her doctorate degree. She's 83 years young and she still wants to attend classes. Yes, if you can tell by my articulation, I am a Southerner. Yes, I'm from the great state of Tennessee. What else can I tell you about me? Let's see. Food. Yeah, we really like it. We like to eat and consume stuff to keep our strength up. Of course, Tennessee is in the Bible Belt region, so you know how that works. What else could I tell you about me? Of course, we love football down here. I mean, you guys do in Michigan as well, but it's our oxygen down here in the South. You all have heard of the SEC. I'm sure that you have. What else could I tell you about us, about me? I attended private school. I graduated from a college here in Tennessee. All of those pieces that are about me. Most people don't know I'm a fish out of water. I double majored in biology and chemistry, minored in psych. I was going to medical school. did all of those kinds of things. And somebody challenged me to get into real estate. That was 37 years ago that they challenged me to get in real estate. And I have not looked back. I want you to know that I am a motorcycle enthusiast and I love to let my hair blow in the wind when I get a chance. Now, let me ask you the question. How do you think my culture has shaped me? If these are some insights about me and the things that I have been inundated with, Bible Belt guy, likes to eat, raised in the South, Does it bring to your mind some kind of thoughts about me that you may have been told or taught in the culture that you exist in? And here's a question. How do you know that any of those things are true? If you haven't engaged with me and you haven't talked to me, how would you know that any of the things that you think about me are actually true? See, this is what happens with us when we get our orientation as we're brought up. We get our orientation from other people. And I'm not upset when we get our orientation from other people. Here's what I always say. Once we grow up and we know what the truth is, our truth, then the only thing for us to do is change it or not. We were taught in our culture, our formative years, the truth of other people. So once we grow up and we're all grown up and we know what our truth is, do we change? Do we make things different? You were told this as a child and all your formative years, but now as an adult, you see that it's not that way. Then the only person that can change that is me or you. Let me give you some more real quick because I'm watching my time. Personal biases. We all have them. What is a bias, by the way? It's what we tend to have a favorable or an unfavorable feeling toward. I'm going to tell you, I'm biased to things that are cooked in a Southern tradition. I want to tell you that I am biased to the weather and the climate that I have in the South. I want to tell you that I'm biased to the Tennessee Titans. That doesn't mean that I don't like the Detroit Lions. But what it means is that I have a personal bias to what it is that I have value with, that I have association with. Every one of us has a personal bias. Recognizing it is going to be important for us to do. What else can I tell you? Well, implicit bias is a little bit different. It is a bias, but it is a bias that you don't even realize that you have. How many of you like vanilla ice cream? Do you know why you like vanilla ice cream? Have you always eaten vanilla ice cream? Well, why don't you like chocolate ice cream? Well, I have nothing against chocolate ice cream, but every time I go to the ice cream shop, I get vanilla. Well, why is that you get vanilla each and every time when they have all of these different flavors there? Well, I mean, they're okay, but I just prefer vanilla. Well, I look at that as implicit bias. You don't even know why you get what you get. You just know that you get it. You may not know why you think the way you think, but you just think it. Guess what? Somebody can look at me and says, oh, Robert's a bad guy. Well, why am I a bad guy? Well, I just have always been taught that you were a bad guy. And I might ask the question, have I done something to you? And you would say, no. I asked the question, has somebody like me done something to you? And you said, no. I said, has somebody like me done something to your family or imposed upon you in any way? And you say, no. And I say, well, why don't you like me? What have I done? The rationale that you don't like me. I don't know. Implicit biases are things that we do not even realize that we have. The key is actually realizing that we have implicit biases. They are unconsciously assigned stereotypical traits that we associate with certain groups. You know, people in the South are lazy. Oh, really? Where do we get that from? Well, people in the West, those are those tree huggers, you know, out there. They just, you know, but people in the East believe in fossil fuels. But the people in the West believe in environmental deals. It's just different. It's a different orientation of where we are. But implicit biases that we have, sometimes we don't even realize that we have them. Here's what I'm going to tell you. Such these things, right? Implicit bias is developed over one's lifetime. It starts as early as our childhood. So people start putting things in, what we see. Don't go over there, that's bad over there. Don't go in that neighborhood, that's a bad neighborhood. Don't do this. And you go like, okay, because people you trust told you that. So now over your lifetime, you don't go in certain places and you go like, well, why? You say, well, I just don't go there. But you don't have any rationale as to why you don't. Well, that is where that impression has been made upon us in what we do. I'm going to finish this slide with this statement. Such biases are often heavily influenced and reinforced by the stereotypical representations of groups that we see in the media. I watch television totally different. When I look at a television show, I says, okay, who's Prince Charming? They'll tell me. Who's going to get the girl? They'll tell me. Who is going to be the criminal? Who is going to be the drug dealer? Who is going to be the person that robbed the bank, depending? In the movies, they portray different characters. But our mind and subconscious cannot separate the two. It may be a black or brown actor that just accepted that particular role. It doesn't mean that that particular person is in real life that bad person or not. But sometimes we have a problem with not being able to associate with what is right and not because of what's being pumped in. This is what we call implicit bias. I think you got it. Let me go on. How can we get more diversified? How can we become more inclusive in our association or our company or even in our personal lives? Because you know what? We don't know how to do it. We don't know the best way to start it. We don't know how to ask the right questions, all of those things. And we have an assembly of speakers who are going to help you with that that come in later this day. But let me tell you this. I'm going to pick two areas real quick because my time is running out. So let me go to the next one. The secrets to embracing diversity, equity, and inclusion. The first piece that I want to talk about is the outreach program for clients. And the second is going to be the realtor's role. So let me go to the outreach first. When I go to the outreach first, you need to widen or broaden your tent. It says that you need to actually open it more, because here's what businesses know. It says the more people that they include in their tent, the wider their tent is, the more stable their business becomes, and the more income that they can possibly earn. So with each one of you, association, business, your personal real estate company being you, incorporated, have you made an attempt to be as inclusive as you possibly can across the spectrum with all people? If you have not, then the recommendation is that maybe you ought to look to see how you might be able to broaden your tent, how you might be able to widen the tent up and to make things happen for you. What else would you do? You need to look and be welcoming. And even that, you need to know what the demographics are. You need to know if you're in a certain market, who is in that market. And once we identify who's in that market, then guess what we can do? We can actually address the pain point that they have or provide a product or service. So let me make sure, Robert, I've identified it. Yes, I address the pain point and then I create the marketing materials that relate to the desired audience. In other words, I give them what they want. So if I'm going to broaden this tent, I'm going to actually have more client outreach. I want to look and be welcoming. I want to know the demographics so I can identify who the population is. I want to find out what their pain point or how to address whatever their product or service needs are. And then I want to give it to them. Now, I know that sounded monumental, right? But that's how we make it work. Have you looked at your demographics in your area that you service? What is needed in that area? Those things are going to be important. So let's go to the role of the realtor. What, how, why, when, and what if? All right. So what is the role of the realtor in this thing called equity and inclusion? That's a great question, and I'm glad you had the thought. Here's what I'll tell you about it. Here's what the realtor's role really is. In the United States, we have struggled to overcome a history of prejudice and discrimination in an effort to live up to those lofty ideals of equality for all. Secondly, we look at it and we said, well, what we've done also, what's the next point for me? Thank you. What was promised on paper never actually was granted in practice. It was good that we talked about it, but it never came to fruition. And then we discovered the Jim Crow. They established separate but equal status for Black Americans, right? That legalized discrimination and denied equal access and opportunity in all aspects of society. That even includes owning a home. These laws that we just referenced, they are laws that endured for over 100 years, well into the 20th century. Next slide for me. Here's one of the things that we teach when we talk about at-home and diversity as I start to wrap. When we look at these pieces, we look and it says, well, why is there a big emphasis on this? Why is this a problem? Because early in the 20th century, housing discrimination was an ethical mandate for realtors. And this is from 1928. This is one of the pieces that came through. So let me show you how our code read back then. Article 34 said, a realtor should never be instrumental in introducing into a neighborhood a character of property or occupancy, members of any race or nationality, or any individuals whose presence would clearly be detrimental to the property values in that neighborhood. Now, here's what I want you to understand. This was legal. This is our NAR. This was one of the codes. So guess what? If you did that to any neighborhood, you were brought before professional standards for violation of the code of ethics of the National Association of Realtors. So people go like, well, why are realtors? What's our role? We played a critical role back then. And we're making strides to actually correct what those things were. So that's the attempt that we have. Next slide for me, please. Realtors can help in a couple of ways. Segregation, it didn't happen by accident. We had the redlining pieces. We had all of those things come to fruition. What else did we have? A broad range of actors, including federal government, banks, real estate agencies, they ensured for decades that African Americans or Black and Brown would be kept out of the new homes and the flourishing neighborhoods. With that in mind, by building an inclusive business, expanding home ownership, providing buyers with broad ranges of housing choices, today's realtors, that'd be me and you, we can help create an America where there's no one is denied the opportunity to own a home, build wealth, and to prosper on account of what their race is. As I wrap up to finish, here's what I'm going to say. This is a prime opportunity. So let's seize the opportunity. We need a coming together. We need a move back to respecting each other, treating others like we would want to be treated. Also, we need open lines of communication, acceptance of differences and tolerance, not always agreeing, but allowing a different opinion will go a long way to building bridges, mending fences, and creating a better world for all of us. So I will end in saying to you, I think I am about there. Do I have anything else? Yes. I'm going to say it's a plumb pleasing pleasure to be able to talk with you all today. I thank you for your attention and time. But don't let it end with me. We have some great people coming after me who are going to give you some very good stuff. And later on, we'll talk to you with a Q&A session. I'll see you a little bit later. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. I appreciate your explanation of implicit bias. My name is Jay Sanders, and I am the chair of the Diversity and Inclusion Committee. Robert just got us off started so well. you will be seeing a couple other committee members throughout the event. But before we introduce our next speaker, I am excited to announce that we have a fun giveaway package of Young Lives Thieves Oil cleaning products donated by Megan Keat from It's Essential. Please drop a note in the chat to indicate that you are present if you hear your name. If you do not, then the prize will go to another winner. Our winner is Kevin Chrisbrook. Now, I am pleased to introduce you to Carol Borden. Carol is the founder and CEO of Guardian Angels Medical Service Dogs, which may be familiar to our GMAR members since we donated and supported to Guardian Angels for 5 years. Carol is going to talk to us about support animals and housing laws related to people with support animals. Please welcome Carol Borden.
Thank you so much. And thank you for inviting me. This is such an important topic. Of course, Robert's going to be a hard act to follow. I appreciate his insights so very much. I'm really honored to be here today to talk about one of our most vulnerable sectors of our society, and that is our disabled society. Many of us don't realize that we're actually talking with or dealing with someone with a disability. And there's so few service dogs really visually out there that people would recognize. And then there's problems with that too, with inappropriate service dogs and imposter dogs, but mostly a lot of confusion. We have nearly 57 million people in the United States with disabilities. Not all of those would, of course, be situations that would be appropriate for a service dog. But I know many of you are probably scratching your head thinking, really, that many people, 57 million people with disabilities? But what you must remember is there is a difference between visible and invisible disabilities. So just as a little exercise, I always ask in my presentation, so we'll do it here virtually as well. If you yourself, a family member or someone you know, has PTSD, please note that in your head. If someone you know, a family member or yourself, has a diabetic issue, imbalance, please notate that in your head. If someone you know, a family member or yourself, has a seizure disorder, please notate that in your head. Now, with that being said, when I'm doing one-on-one presentations, I normally have about 90% of the hands up in the room at this point because I've asked them to raise their hand. And all the things I just mentioned were invisible disabilities. And so those are things that we don't even think about. And that was only three. There are numerous, numerous different types of invisible disabilities. Now, for many of those, there are support animals. So we can go to the next slide. So let's talk about what is a support animal. You know, we've all heard about assistance animals, service animals, emotional support animals, medical service dogs, therapy dogs, companion dogs, psychiatric dogs. Wow, it's enough to make your head explode, right? There are so many different things that are called by different names. So I'm going to explain to you what the differences are and how these things are going to impact you in your job going forward. So let's start with service dogs. Basically, an assistance dog, a medical service dog, those are all the same thing. And so we have to understand that a service dog is described by federal law as a dog. Actually, they call it a service animal. But a service animal is a dog that has been trained with a set of skills that mitigate a person's disability, and it is for an individual, not for a group of people, just one person. And they had some really good lobbyists because where appropriate, miniature horses are also considered service animals. You just don't see them as frequently. Service dogs have public access privileges where no other category of dogs do. They are not required to have any identification, any ID, any bandana, anything like that. So it makes your job a little bit more difficult if they're not wearing a vest to really decipher who's real, who isn't. And again, keep in mind, a lot of people abuse the privilege of having a dog in public, but the only dog that is federally protected to be in public is a working service dog. And a working service dog can be any breed. This is not breed discriminate. It can be a mixed breed, it can be a purebred. Even in cities that have breed bans on Rottweilers, pit bulls, things like that, if this dog is trained to be a service dog, it no longer falls under any of those categories. So an individual breed of dog can never be restricted because they are not, by law, even considered pets of any kind. They are considered a working dog that is protected by federal law. So we can go on to the next slide. So just to give you a little bit of education on what the difference is, the next slide is on therapy dogs. So everyone has heard of a therapy dog, but you may not understand exactly what their function is. They're usually a very well-behaved, happy dog that goes into hospitals, nursing homes, assisted living places, and they bring some sunshine for that individual. We even see them in courtrooms to help keep children in particular calmer if they're having to testify. But these dogs are just really well-behaved family dogs that have gone through their therapy courses to become certified. And at the end of the day, they go home with their mom and dad. They're not doing any special skills for an individual with disabilities, and they definitely do not have any public access privileges. So if we can move on to the next slide, the next category of dogs that we're going to talk about, which will become very relevant in our talk about FHA and HUD laws, are emotional support dogs. Now, listen, those of you who have a pet, we all know that every dog gives us some level of emotional support, right? Even a working service dog, our pets at home. But there is a separate definition, not by federal law, but by HUD law and FHA, recognizing emotional support dogs. Now, keep in mind, these dogs have not been trained with any special skill set. They're just there to help someone be calmer, especially someone who has perhaps high anxiety. Again, these dogs do not have any public access rights. Okay. Now, if we move on to the next slide, we have our companion dogs, and this is everybody's pet. These are our dogs that we have for pure company, social pleasure. They don't have any special training. They're not a working dog. And again, they are not allowed in public, nor are they afforded any benefits under HUD, airlines, any of these other places. So let's talk a little bit more about federal law. So if we can move on to the next slide. The first federal law was enacted in 1990 under Americans with Disabilities. But unfortunately, the language wasn't very specific. So that's where you started seeing all these different animals coming out of the woodwork with our age of technology. People began to see, you saw stories on TV and the newspapers on peacocks and snakes and guinea pigs and all these different things that people were claiming to be their service animal. Well, in 2012, they changed the law as they realized this was a huge problem. And so now the law does specify that a service animal is a dog only and, where appropriate, a miniature horse. So it's very important when you see all this plethora of other things out there that someone is calling a service animal that is no longer being recognized by federal law. Again, let me reiterate, there are no requirements to have paperwork or identification on a true service dog. Now, what makes this whole thing very confusing is we have federal law, and then we have all these executive branches of the law, and they all have different rules. So you've got ADA, but then you have HUD, you've got DOD, you've got the VA, you've got the DOTs, and oh my gosh, again, your head feels like it's exploding if you try to know the difference between all of those different regulations. So for simplicity today, we'll move to the next slide, and we're going to just talk about the rights again of a service animal. So under Title 2 and 3 of the ADA, and this includes all state and local governments, businesses, nonprofit organizations, anyone who generally serves the public, they must allow service animals to accompany people with disabilities in all areas of their facilities, wherever the public normally is allowed to go. They have all the same rights and privileges. We cannot discriminate against them. There's a lot of reasons people think they should discriminate against them that they think are legitimate, but they truly are not. And all of these things hold true for housing regulations. So again, we'll move to the next slide. Also, you need to know that all service dogs should have some type of a leash, a harness, a tether, unless that prevents that disabled individual, it prevents the dog from performing its task or skill for that individual, in which case they must be under thorough voice command or hand signal. Now, I will tell you, we have hundreds and hundreds of service dog teams working across the United States. We're in our 11th year. We deal with all different types of disabilities. And not that it doesn't exist, but it should be extremely rare that you see someone with a service dog that isn't on a leash. We just don't find that the leash inhibits their functions. Now, let's talk about some of those reasons that I referred to that people think it might be okay to discriminate. Obviously, there's people with allergies, there's people that are afraid of dogs, there's cultures that have been raised where dogs are not part of a family, and those are all reasonable in your own mind. However, these are not legitimate reasons under the law for denying someone to have their service dog with them in whatever public environment they are in. I think the easiest thing to remember is not only is a service dog not a pet, but if you will think of it as a piece of medical equipment, it just happens to have a heartbeat and everybody wants to pet it, but don't do that either. We'll talk about that in a minute. So it's very important to understand, even though the dog is very quiet and you may not see it doing anything, that's probably the mark of a true service dog that has been properly trained, because they are only going to respond and react to the needs of their recipient when it's necessary. You know, they don't necessarily have a sugar imbalance all the time, or they're not necessarily going to have a seizure any minute. So the dog isn't going to be alerting or helping them with their mobility every second, but they are right there being as invisible as possible whenever they are not having to perform a task. A person cannot be asked to remove his dog or be denied access unless, and there are merchant rights too, if that dog is out of control and the handler doesn't take immediate action to get him back in check, or the dog is going around marking things, you know, obviously that is not a housebroken animal if he's going around lifting his leg on things. That is totally inappropriate. So yes, in instances like that, he can be asked to take the dog out. He can come back in without the dog. Merchants have rights too. But in the end, this team cannot be treated differently from any other patron. They cannot be refused housing or rentals. They cannot be charged pet fees or cleaning fees, anything that wouldn't normally be charged to a patron without an animal, without a pet. All fees must be waived. Under no circumstance is this animal considered a pet. So any pet regulations do not apply, because remember, what did I say? They are medical equipment. All right, great. Next slide, please. So if you have someone who wants to rent a home, buy a home, as a realtor, you do need to give them the same courtesy as you would any other client. They do get to tour a house. They do get to rent an apartment or any other home. But what we do ask in the case of HUD is that they request a reasonable accommodation. So what is a reasonable accommodation? We need to pop down a couple of slides here. A reasonable accommodation sounds scary. It sounds like, oh my gosh, what do I have to do different? I have to put in a ramp. I have to do something to accommodate. No, you don't have to do any of that. A reasonable accommodation does not require you to change your business model in any way, shape, or form. It is simply this person saying, I have a disability for which I require a service animal. And it's very important that you recognize their need for this animal. You're allowed two legal questions to determine if this is a service dog or not. And the first thing you ask, of course, is this a service dog? 99.9% of the time, they're going to say yes. And then you ask, well, what task is this dog trained to do for you? And they never have to tell you their medical condition. You should never ask what's wrong with you. And you'd be amazed how many times we get that. But instead, you simply want to expect an answer of specific tasks. This dog alerts to my medical condition, or he helps me with my balance, or he helps me with my mobility. But take this into consideration also. As human beings, we're visual creatures. That's why at the beginning of my presentation, I asked you to think about what the invisible disabilities may be. So if we have someone who comes up to us visibly with braces on their legs, they're in a wheelchair, they have a white cane, they have a cochlear implant, any of the things that show you visually that they have a disability and they have a service dog with them and the service dog is quiet and well-behaved, then you know what? You really have already made that determination. The FHA received 60% of their complaints last year had to do with denying access to people with disabilities that had service dogs. So you have to use your own good judgment. If everything looks appropriate, the dog is behaving correctly, the person tells you, yes, I have a disability, then you really don't need to go any further. You can fill out the paperwork that says, yes, this person should be allowed a reasonable accommodation. Now, going to the next slide. What if the person could not answer that question? Perhaps the person did have an emotional support dog. And what makes it very confusing is even though we learned a few minutes ago about service dogs and the federal law, HUD law says an assistance dog can either A, be a service dog, or B, a dog trained or untrained to do tasks. So, wow, how confusing is that? Basically, this is a guideline to give you a basis for determination. So if they tell you, no, this is not a service dog, or they tell you they don't answer the questions correctly that are task-based, they say the dog makes me feel better, then absolutely you should go forward in asking for the correct documentation from their doctors, from their Social Security disability copy of that. But again, you cannot ask them what's wrong with you. All right, so be very careful on how you pursue that. And again, if you have a dog that is acting up, they cannot present any type of the documentation necessary, you do then have the right to deny them. But you do not, in fact, it is illegal to deny them housing if they do, in fact, have a service dog or an emotional support dog. And they can also request this determination at any time. Perhaps they moved into housing and did not have a service dog at that time, but got it later on. They can apply for that at any point before or during, and even another member of the family can do it for them. So in wrapping up, I would just like to remind you something a little bit about service dog etiquette, if we can go to the next slide. And when you see these dogs, they should be behaving appropriately, quietly. Like I said, you only have the two legal questions that you can ask. And please do not pet the service dog. While he may be friendly and he may act like, you know, he's cute as a button, I don't think you make it a habit of going up and petting someone's wheelchair, do you? So don't pet the dog. He is a piece of medical equipment. He is there for a purpose. And it's very, very important that you not distract him from his job, because it could have catastrophic consequences for his handler. And again, don't ask what their disability is. It makes them very uncomfortable. And keep in mind, all these folks typically have some level of anxiety. And how you treat them is so important, because for many of the people we deal with, we have had people that have been self-isolated as long as 25 years. Some people haven't been out of their own bedroom in 6 months until they get their service dog. We integrate them back into public. And so you don't know how long this person has even been able to live a semi-normal life once again. And your behavior, your response to them, and how you speak to them could be the difference in them being able to go forward with their new life or sending them back down into a very serious spiral. So I hope this presentation has been helpful to you. And I hope that you have learned something that will be of value to you going forward. And thank you again so much. Hope you enjoyed the pictures too.
Thank you, Carol. I really liked how you explained that there are visible and invisible disabilities. So thank you again. I am Claudia Hernandez, another GMAR committee member, and I am excited to announce that our next prize is the Ultimate Closing Package, which includes an interior design consultation with Tanya Brigades Designs, a gift card from Donnie's Desserts and Catering, a full service from the Glory Room Hair Salon, and a reusable cooler bag filled with goodies from Otis Sheetham Inspections. A $230 total value. This is a great gift for your next client, or keep it and treat yourself. And our next winner is Irenita Godert. So now I'm very pleased to introduce to you our next speaker, Jamie Zapata. Jamie was the first openly transgender realtor in San Antonio, Texas. And she's also the founding president of the San Antonio chapter of the National Association of LGBT Real Estate Professionals. Jamie's going to talk to us about the importance of trans awareness and inclusion. So please welcome Jamie Zapata.
Hi, thank you so much. I really appreciate the introduction. I would love to start off by sharing a story about an open house that I recently held. And I'm sure it probably hasn't happened to anyone else here, but I was getting ready for my open house and I had my little cookies and I was fluffing the pillows, getting ready when the first gentleman of the day walked in and he looked at the house and he looked at me and he said, "Wow, I've never seen a transgender realtor before." And I said, "Well, now you have." And he didn't really mean any harm. He was just genuinely shocked to see a trans person in an open house because of the stereotypes that society places on trans people. We're often limited to stereotypical jobs in entertainment, hair, makeup, that kind of thing. And those are great jobs, but we shouldn't be limited to any specific career. And, you know, I might be able to do someone's makeup, but I can definitely sell houses, and sometimes I can do it even better. And again, my name is Jamie Zapata, and I'm a realtor with Coldwell Banker, Dion Harper Realtors here in San Antonio, Texas. And today I'm going to share a little bit about how I ended up in a career in real estate and why trans inclusion is so important. About 3 years ago, I became the first out and open trans realtor in San Antonio. And people often will ask me if I really want to be known as the trans realtor. And they say that being trans shouldn't define me, but it does define me, and it's defined every aspect of my life. So I embrace it. And whether other people like it or not, I am a Mexican-American transgender woman, and I'm proud of it. And of course, I'm very lucky to be where I am now, but things definitely weren't always this easy. I actually grew up in the 80s, and back then, I didn't even know what trans meant. I didn't know any other trans people. I thought I was the only one in the whole world. But I can remember as far back as when I was about 3 years old, and I always looked and acted feminine, and I always felt like a girl, but everybody would just tell me that I needed to be a boy. And no matter what they said, I knew that I was meant to be a girl and nothing was going to stop me. Unfortunately, I was bullied and beaten up and harassed by pretty much anyone and everyone, by other kids, by teachers, by neighbors, pretty much anyone and everyone, just because I was too feminine. And that was pretty much every day. So I was determined. And by the age of about 10 years old, I started letting my hair grow out longer. And when I was about 13, I started to wear makeup. But I'd be sent home from school because back then I wasn't allowed to transition in school by the school district. So by that time, I was extremely feminine and the bullying had gotten worse. And some high school kids were actually planning to lure me to a party where they were going to make me strip and then they were going to kill me. And luckily, a friend tipped me off, and so I didn't get killed. But the bullying was so bad that after I finished eighth grade, after I guess I was about 14, I was forced to drop out of school so that I could be my authentic self 24/7. And I never did go to high school, but I was just so happy to finally be free. And I didn't look back. So I didn't actually get to go to high school, but I didn't regret it. And the next few years were hard because during that time, my father felt that I didn't need any toiletries, like hair, makeup, clothes or shoes, since I wasn't going to school. So during those years, I had to beg, borrow, and steal everything that I had. But I was so excited at the age of 17 because I got my first job until I realized that society was not ready to accept trans people in the workplace either. And I was the butt of everyone's jokes, and I was pointed at, stared at, harassed, and it was, those years were hard during that time because I was fired from so many jobs because I was considered to be a distraction to other employees because they weren't able to get their jobs done because they were too busy gossiping about me. And a lot of people didn't want to share a restroom with me. And they would say that I needed to use the single stall restroom. And I would say, well, if someone has a problem with me, then they can use the single stall restroom. And of course I'd be fired and I'd go on to the next job. And then one coworker actually approached me in the restroom and she said, oh, Jamie, we just all want you to know that we know what you are. but it's okay. And you have our permission to work here. And I thought, okay, well, thank you. And I know what you are. And you have my permission to work here too. You know, who says that, right? And so, you know, that was just one example. And another job, two girls claimed that I had trapped them. And they actually sued me and the company because they claimed that I had trapped them in a bathroom stall and tried to convert them, which I have no idea what that means. But luckily, the lawsuit was dropped because I had never been in the restroom with them in the first place. And so after years of that, I pretty much gave up trying to fit in at work. And I started to do modeling and entertainment in order to support myself. And it wasn't something that I wanted to do, but it's what I had to do in order to survive. And so during that time, I was actually making pretty good money. And I had always wanted to live in the suburbs. And so I bought a house in the suburbs because I thought it was beautiful and peaceful and quiet. And unfortunately, my neighbors did not love me. So they would stand outside with their arms folded, giving me dirty looks all day and reporting me to the HOA for every little thing. And they would call the police on me for no reason. And so after about 7 years, I gave up. I thought, oh, Lord, what was I thinking? You know, trying to live in the suburbs, a trans person, I mean, of all things, how could I, right? So I sold my house and I moved to the city. And so then after that, I started to feel hopeless and I felt discarded by society. And I really didn't place any value on my life at all. I felt, what difference does it make if I live or die, if there's no place for me in this world? And unfortunately, I was being reckless on purpose because I didn't value my life. And in 2017, I was diagnosed with HIV. And when I was diagnosed with HIV, I realized that I don't want to die and my life does matter. So I decided to, of course, I immediately got on treatment. And I'm healthy and the medicine works and I'm doing well. And I decided that I wanted to make a change to try to help myself and to try to do things to potentially help others like me avoid falling into that same situation, that the challenges that I've experienced. So I studied for my GED, even though I thought I would never learn math, but luckily I passed on the first try and I got my GED. And then I went, excuse me. After I got my GED, I enrolled in real estate school and I passed on the first try. And I thought, okay, well, I'm going to go and I'm going to interview with the legendary brokerage here in San Antonio, which is Coldwell Banker Dan Harper Realtors. And I thought, well, I don't know if it's going to work out, but I've been fired from every other job. So what's one more, right? And so, you know, I did the interview and I didn't say I was trans and they didn't ask and things were going well. I got the job. And I was selling houses and everything was going really well. And I started to realize that clients were being discriminated against for being LGBT. And I was hearing stories about people being denied service at open houses because they were a male couple who wanted to start a family and the realtor at that open house had rejected them. And so that's when I started the local chapter of the National Association of LGBT Real Estate Professionals. And I became the first trans person in leadership with the organization. So I'm proud of that. And I also received awards for Rookie of the Year. And I received the Pinnacle Award from Nagle Rep. And I also received a Wells Fargo Community Service Award for a Realty Community Service Award for Good Neighbor. And so I was doing really well. And I'm proud to say that I encouraged two other trans agents to join our office. So now there's three trans people in my office, which means that we're the first trans real estate team in the world. And that's really exciting. Of course, I have lost clients because I'm trans. And, you know, we all have issues with gaining clients' trust. You know, they might think, for me, it's another layer of challenges because the people might think, well, do I really want this person sign in my yard? What are the neighbors going to think? And of course, I've lost clients because of it. But I don't worry about it because I figure, you know, if somebody doesn't want to work with me, I don't want to work with them either. So I just focus on the people who do want my help. And for trans people purchasing, like buying and selling homes, there's actually a lot of anxiety because during the home buying and selling process, we have to out ourselves. We have to provide documents regarding our name changes and or potentially credit checks or, you know, background verification that was in a previous name. And that can cause extreme anxiety for some people, and it can cause trans people to avoid the home buying process altogether. And so that's really sad. Now, since there's two other trans agents in my office, we've actually helped a lot of trans clients buy and sell homes. So people that didn't even realize that they could do this and actually open up to people, and they're looking for people that they can feel safe around. So we're happy about that. And in the beginning, though, when we were in the office, it hadn't been openly discussed that we were trans. So we were walking around the office on eggshells thinking the call's going to come in saying, sorry, you're a distraction. You know, we're going to have to let you go. And so we really didn't know what was going to happen. But one day, oh, actually, it's not like I'm trying to hide being trans because I'm 10 feet tall and I wear 10 pounds of makeup. So I wasn't exactly trying to hide it, but we hadn't openly discussed it until one day we sat down with my broker, Lisa Harper Rispoli, at our annual Realtor conference, and we sat down and had a conversation with her about being trans, and we opened up and she asked questions. And I said, Lisa, I hope it's okay that we're doing all this volunteering in the LGBT community because we just don't want to make the company look bad. And she said, oh no, you know, please go ahead, keep doing what you're doing. And I said, oh, Lisa, thank you so much, because all we really want is to be included. And she said, I don't like that word included. Don't use that word. And I thought, uh-oh. And she said, honey, you're welcome here. And we're lucky to have you. And for a trans person to finally be welcomed, you have no idea what that means. And for some of us, it could literally mean the difference between life and death. So this is why it's so important that all of us embrace diversity and accept people for who they are and welcome people of all backgrounds. And in case, for everyone watching, in case you don't know any other trans people, now you can say you know at least one, and you can let everyone know that we're not crazy and that you will see us in open houses and you'll see us walking, talking, living, and thriving. And I just want to thank everyone for the opportunity to speak today, because it really proves, you know, to allow me to share my story, because it really proves that trans people can accomplish great things when we're given the opportunity. Thank you very much.
Wow, I tell you what, thank you so much, Jamie. Thank you for sharing your personal journey and showing that you are a marvelous human being. I think that people on this call can't help but grow from your life experiences and what you've shared, and just with the passion and conviction that you actually run with it. So I'm going to tell you, keep going, keep making a positive difference, and that you do have support. So when you need to reach out, you reach out anytime, because believe it or not, I can relate.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Robert. And thank you for sharing your story. I've learned a lot from you today. And thank you so much.
You're more than welcome. Well, guys, we're going ahead to have a quick break right now. We want you to refill your beverages. We want you to stretch out. Do whatever it is that you need to do, because we got some more fantastic stuff coming back at you. Take 10 and we'll see you then. Well, actually, it's going to be 11:30. So let me just tell you, 11:30 is the time. So I'll see you at 11:30.
Don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. And won't you please say hello to the folks that I know, tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
Thank you.
she'll meet him Sunday, maybe Monday, maybe not. Still, I'm sure to meet him one day, maybe Tuesday, he'll be my good news day. He'll build a little home just meant for two, from which I'll never roam. What would you do? And so all else above, I'm dreaming of the man I love.
No, not at all.
Come out and paint a world of blue. There's my heart right up your sleeve, waiting on.
Go ahead, Frank.
Welcome back, everyone, to the Equity and Inclusion Conference. I am Frank Torella, a GMAR director and board member, and we have already heard from three amazing speakers. Before we get into the second half of our conference, we have another prize, a Realtor package from GMAR. This includes several fun items from our GMAR tool shop in a spring green. And our winner is Tammy Van Dusen. Congratulations, Tammy. Our next speaker, Eric Thomas, is a Detroit native who holds the official title of Detroit Storyteller. Eric has been a featured speaker at TEDx Detroit, the Digital Summit, the Industrial Design Society of America, and many other events. He owns a marketing agency where 60% of his employees and vendors are people of color and women. Eric is going to talk to us about addressing our own implicit bias. Please welcome Eric Thomas.
Well, hello there. Funny enough story, it's now 100% people of color and women, but thank you for having me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen and kind of walk through this conversation about implicit bias. What I'm not going to do, I want to get this out of the way, because I'm the angry speaker, so welcome. What I'm not going to do is try and convince you that racism is real. What I'm not going to do is try and give you a bunch of data and statistics to prove it. A dude had an air freshener the other day, and I'm not trying to hear it. So if this is the life that we're in, we're going to have a conversation about implicit bias. And so I am going to share my screen really quickly. Boop. And boop and bap. But first, we are going to start off on kind of why this is going on. Okay, so check it out. The thing about humans that are really interesting is that humans love patterns. It's how our brains work. We seek patterns, we find patterns. It's why we have language. It's what separates us from almost every other entity on Earth, because not only do we find patterns, everywhere we look, we turn them into things and then we pass those things forward. And it's really incredible. It results in things like fight or flight, right? If you hear something in the bushes, it could be a bunny rabbit or it could be a tiger. But the question is, do we want to wait around to find out? Maybe not. Some of those folks who got out of Dodge before something bad happened to them survived. And the people that didn't run away, they didn't, right? And so we carry a lot of these prehistoric predispositions in our DNA, like in our genetic code. And so we believe that the patterns that we find are life and death. But here's the thing that's really interesting. When we emerged from the woods, we kept a lot of these same things, these same anxieties, these same quick pattern recognitions that allow us to decide on a trigger what is safe, what is safety. We reflexively seek things that are dangerous in places that are safe. This looks dangerous to me, I'm gonna avoid it. That looks safe, I'm gonna go near it. The people that seem similar to me, that speak like me, that like the same things I like, I'm gonna go that way because it seems safe. The things over there that I don't really understand, the things I'm unfamiliar with, that seems dangerous. I'm not even gonna engage with that. But what does safety mean in this context? Does it mean more police? Does it mean I get bigger stakes? No, usually safety means normalcy. It means things that are simple. That to me looks like something I understand. I feel seen, therefore I feel safe. We listen for similar accents, similar culture. We heard about culture earlier. The things that make us feel like I belong there. But here's the thing. What is normal anyways? What defines normal? Well, usually the apex predator defines normal, right? Whoever is the king defines normal. Whoever defines your company culture defines what's normal. But here's the problem. If you have a homogenous leadership group, we all have the same type of culture. And somebody who's from somewhere else, who believes something else, who eats something else, who has a different religion as you, are they not normal? Or are they othered based upon their context? There are a billion Indian people, right? If someone comes from India and lands in America, are they not normal if they maintain their custom? They came from a place where a billion people felt the same way. And so when we talk about normalcy, when we talk about safety and how it tints how we view where we want to engage and who we invite into our circles, I think it's important that we remember that normal is relative. And so I want to talk about a term that I hate. It is the melting pot. I hate that phrase. I hate the term. America is the great melting pot where everybody comes in who is different, and we take them and we put them in a hot mold and we strain out everything that's different and they become more like us. What is the point of celebrating diversity if you melt all of the interesting things out of it? In many cultures, business or country or cultural, standing out is frowned upon because it slows the gears. It grinds the progress to a halt because we have to adjust for others. But what we don't talk about is the greatness that comes from diversity, right? America is an amalgamation of different languages and foods and identities and cultures. And what makes us interesting is that all of these things have come together. Some things have been stolen. Some things have been taken. Some things have been culturally appropriated. We'll talk about that later. But all of these different things make this place unique. The thing that I want to explain is that bias is natural to us. It is something that brings us together, which is kind of messed up. And so there are a lot of things that are natural to us. Pissing in the woods is natural to us. But as we've evolved, we realize that maybe we need to try a new way. And so when we think about what we've used to get where we are, versus what we can do to make the world a better place for all of those around us, we have to remember that being a human is to socially evolve, is to understand what makes us unique. A lot of this started, well, I'm not going to talk about colonialization because that would be a whole another rage fest, but when America started to standardize. We love this idea, right, of things being the same. It became simple. All the plastic cups and all the plates and all the different things. We sought the great average. What is the most standard thing we could possibly have? So we must have the same haircuts. And so we must have the same looks. We must have the same build. We must have the same clothes. We must have the same yada yada. In the 50s, that was all the rage. And when everybody was making decisions looked exactly the same, those of us who did not fit that mold had to work hard to get as close to the average as possible. It created an approximation to whiteness, and it seeped into culture. And so you look at it decades later, and there are still people that are seeking to be like the ruling class. And so the people who are and have been in charge have not had to reconcile it because you haven't had to adapt. Now you'll say, well, I have had to adapt. I act a little different at work than I do at home. And I'm sure that you do. But there are people who cannot be themselves at work at all. People will change their names entirely to fit into the great American mold, the great universal mold, the great universal mold of whiteness. And so when you ask yourself, how much of you have you changed? Have you thought that maybe you're not really sure how much someone else has? One example I always use is, have you ever been around one of your friends who is from another ethnic group, another cultural group, another heritage, and they're hanging out with their family, and suddenly they develop an accent that you've never heard before? It's because they left that accent at home. And so when you are considering how we've been strained down into this great melting pot, it is emotionally as well as mentally taxing to be at work and be someone else entirely. It's exciting to hear and tragic to hear the story that Jamie expressed to us earlier, because she spoke about leaving their identity somewhere else almost as if that was what's expected. And so when they say, hey, you don't, like, we accept you, it's like, I'm not here for your acceptance. I'm not going to be someone else. It takes an incredible amount of courage to say, I'm going to be myself wherever I am. And I don't think that's celebrated enough. And I just want to give Jamie a shout out. I think it's an incredible story. And I think it speaks to a shared experience that most people don't realize. This last point, because I hear people say this a lot, race is a construct. race is a construct. It is, absolutely. Made up, for sure. Absolutely. But here's the thing. There are consequences. Just because someone made it up doesn't mean that people didn't make decisions based upon it. Constructs define our everyday life. Why? Because humans like patterns. And so when we define our reality by the constructs that we create, there are rippling effects. Redlining is an effect of race, of politics, of gender identity. There are pay gaps and wages and all these other sorts of things. The problem with saying and dismissing race as a construct after everything has already settled in and has been defined by race is it allows you to very conveniently escape the consequences for the actions of the prevailing society. Race was a construct. Now race is a defining factor in people's outcomes and their livelihood, from their schools to their education to their outcomes. And so as we think about race and as we think about all of these other things that define what gives us bias, we have to think about what have those constructs done and what have we done to perpetuate those constructs. So we're going to get into that in a second. But first, I want to talk to you about something called the Kuleshov effect. I'm a storyteller, so I like film strategies and these sorts of norms. The Kuleshov effect was created by a guy named Kuleshov to describe how people have their opinions tinted by things in sequence. If you look at this picture of this guy, here this man might be hungry. Here this man might be in mourning. And here, this man might be a creepy ass weirdo. The question about this person's non-expressive face is determined by the things you see in a sequence. Well, how does that affect the real world? I've got this saying that goes, racists love Chicago. Racists love Chicago. Oh my God, every time somebody says Black Lives Matter, every time a police officer shoots somebody, every time something bad happens, some racist will say to you, inevitably, somewhere through their conversation, but what about black on black crime in Chicago? Inevitably, they will always do it. They will always use Chicago. The thing that's really strange about this is the only thing racists know about Chicago is the bean in the crime rate among black people. They don't know about the school system or the education or the lack of access. They don't know about systemic and institutional racism. They don't know about poverty. They don't know about the lack of investment in schooling, the lack of education, investment in jobs. They don't know about the lack of investment in any urban core. The only thing they know about the black community is the rate of black on black crime. Why? When you've ever been in that conversation, have you ever asked yourself why? Well, because the other type of bias that is prevalent in this universe is confirmation bias. The Kuleshov effect shows you that if you're shown a certain number of things in a sequence, you will start to understand them in those contexts. And so how often have we seen this? Well, what's the difference between a terrorist and a disgruntled employee? Well, I've never met a person who was of Arab American descent. And so I've seen a bunch of movies that have shown me that those people are dangerous. But I know sometimes my coworker Bill gets a little upset. That guy looks like my son. That guy looks like my friend. He looks like my dad. He looks like my brother. I know he might be at his end. I think we should give that guy a little bit more grace. But every movie I've ever seen about that guy says that guy's bad. Okay, well, what's the difference between a young white kid who snapped and a young black kid who's a career criminal, even though he's only committed one crime? I call this the innate criminality of melanin, because we've been shown these features so often. We've been told these stories so often and so consistently that when we see it in succession, I know that when I've seen the person looks like my friend, I know that they're a whole person. When I see this other person who is clearly a criminal based upon this movie I just saw with this action star, I know that that is a two-dimensional caricature while this is an entire person. And so my bias is now confirmed by the statistics about the rate of crime in Chicago. I've never seen anybody march about black on black crime. First of all, black on black crime is not a real thing. Black on black crime will not be a real thing until there are other types of on crime. There's never been a such thing as white on white crime or any other on crime. It's only used as a rebuttal to us asking for justice. So that's a whole nother rant. But it's only used in the context of saying, I now confirm my idea that those folks are dangerous. So what can we do, right? I mean, this is all bad news. This is terrible news, right? The whole world's falling apart near its concept. So there is good news. The question is, how do we overcome bias? Well, you don't. We are all saddled with bias. We are humans. I told you this is hardwired into our DNA. But the cool thing about being human is you can grow and you can evolve. I'm going to tell you two stories about ways I've grown and ways that I've evolved. But first, the first thing you have to do is interrogate why you believe things. Hopefully, after I've gone through this little small little feature about the Kuleshov effect and all these other different types of things and innate bias, you start to think about what you're being shown and how you process it. Interrogating your thoughts. If you get in an elevator and a guy gets on who's, say, larger than you or browner than you, and you grab your purse, just ask yourself why you did it. If there's a bunch of people walking down the street who look a certain way, they look a little bit scarier than you're used to, and you jump to the side of the road, just ask yourself why. Start with a little bit of interrogation. Interrogate one's thoughts. Look at your circle. How diverse is your circle? The question for me is not necessarily if you're a white person or only white friends, you're a bad person. For me, it's all about how did this happen? It's weird in a country that's only 60% white that the only people you know are white people, right? The question you have to ask yourself is, why was my subdivision set up this way? Who sold all these houses? Why is the school doing this? How did I even get here? Why do I speak this way? Why do we all agree with these things? Who is in my circle and how did they get there? Is it because you chose a group of great people? Or is it because you were programmed and organized that way? Listen. Okay, I got two stories. One of me not listening and one of me listening. So I will be the guy that has the real conversation about being biased and being a dummy. Some years back, before I was a trans rights advocate, I was an idiot, like most of us. And I got into an argument with someone about Laverne Cox, who's an incredible, powerful, beautiful woman who is an incredible light to the world. I made a Facebook post and said, that is a fine ass man. That is on me. Somebody reached out and said, Eric, that's not correct. It was another trans person I didn't know at the time. And I rebutted them aggressively. I said, you can't define my reality. That's what I said at the time. In the same context, I was defining their reality through my lens. It is not only ignorant, it's egregious, right? It's a projection. Two, I made a post very recently because I was too lazy to wash my dishes. And I was eating waffles with chopsticks. And I was like, look how far we've fallen that I'm eating waffles with chopsticks. One of my Asian friends reaches out to me and says, Eric, I don't know if you understand your influence, but it sounds like you're denigrating chopsticks in relation to forks. It's been some years since I've been an absolute psychopath. And so I stopped and I listened. And I didn't even realize, especially in a time now when Asian hate is at a peak. It's not at its highest because we've had a history of it, but it's definitely at a peak that I stopped and realized that I was not being careful with my words and my influence on others, and how even if I did something that was simple or something I thought that was harmless, doesn't mean that it could do no harm. My job as a person, as a man, as a cisgender male, as a black person, as somebody who has who's above average income, is to listen to people who have experiences that I don't understand, to shut up and absorb and then compare it against my reality. That to me is my job. And last, study. Go and seek people who are experts and people who are telling these stories and sharing their narratives and talking about what they're going through. Because everybody doesn't have time to teach you. And some people are emotionally exhausted by just trying to exist in a world that doesn't want them to exist. And so there are some of us who want to teach and some of us who do not. And for all those who do not, I think it's our job to study. Wrapping this out, I need to talk about systems because I can't talk about this without talking about systems. Important. A, systems do not care about your feelings. Just because you don't want to be a person perpetuating racism doesn't mean that by your very act of supporting certain systems, of doing certain things, of connecting with certain people, of hiring certain types of people that fit your company code, doesn't mean you are not perpetuating it, even if you feel like you're a good person. Systems do not care what's in your heart. If the school system has been defunded at a high rate based upon the property taxes and we don't sell things in those areas and we appraise them at lower rates, which we've seen in the news multiple times, and so that drains that the educational system around the area, it doesn't care that you have a black friend. They do not care what's in your heart. You can perpetuate systems without even knowing you were a part of it. If two people apply for a job and you were one of them and there was a brown person that applied and you didn't kick that person out of the job and someone picked you because you are more normal to them, you have just perpetuated this system of othering. It's not your fault. But if you go to a place, you look around and everybody looks exactly the same, you gotta ask yourself, who's making these decisions and what am I supporting? Being silent in the face of racism, when you hear people speaking over women, when you hear people joking about ethnic differences, you know, maybe you didn't participate, but if you chuckled, if you didn't say anything, if you don't stand up, unfortunately, you are now a participant. And yes, some of this bias is programming, right? You've been programming by media, by news, by stories, by narrative, by all these sorts of things. But here is the good news. Systems have been created by people. Biases are perpetuated by people. And you know what will stop all of that? People. And so it's our job, your job, my job, our job, to take the steps to dismantle systems of oppression, of narratives that perpetuate things that are fundamentally not true and not steeped in reality, but steeped in simplicity. We must open up to complex conversations. We must open ourselves up to the vulnerability of being wrong, to shared stories of when we are wrong. And we must realize that humans evolve, and we are capable of growth. And that is what I got for you. That is me and Implicit Bias. I think Jackie might be muted.
Jackie, we can't hear you.
Yes, thank you. Hey, Eric, thank you so much for that wonderful presentation about our bias and just remembering and reminding us that it is something natural that we all have learned from people, and we, the people, got the power to do something about it. So I appreciate you sharing that with us today. My name is Jackie Bray, and I am a GMAR committee member. And I'm excited to announce that Detroit Dough has donated our next delicious giveaway. Detroit Dough was founded by three African-American millennials in 2017. Since then, they have been featured in more than 15 national and local publications and received the Spirit of Detroit Award for their commitment and effort to better the lives of Detroit residents. You can find Detroit Dough in many retailers across the Metro Detroit area, or you can check out their website. Our winner today for this Detroit Dough gift is Carla Cartwright. Congratulations, Carla. Our next speaker, Jenny Booth Potter, is a racial activist, author, mom, and producer of a video-based web series called The Next Question. Jenny is also a sought-after speaker and is expecting her first book release in early 2022. Jenny is going to talk to us today about the intersection of race and womanhood and why everyone is part of the solution. So please help me welcome Jenny Booth Potter.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. My name is Jenny Booth Potter. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. And like Jackie said, I've been engaging in anti-racism work for nearly 20 years. I live outside of Chicago, and I can attest to what Eric just said, that racists really do love pointing to our city. I live here with my husband and my two kids. Elliot is 6 and Milo is 4. So I thought I'd start out our time together with a story. Since I'm speaking to a group of people in the home buying profession, I figured I'd tell you about the time when my husband and I bought our first home. When we moved from the city of Chicago to our house in the suburbs, one of the real estate listings began with the bold sentence, "Live at the corner of comfort and easy." When we went to go look at the house, there it was. Two street signs on top of each other marking Comfort Street and Easy Street. That is literally the closest intersection. House on Comfort at the intersection of Easy Street. I mean, even if it's a tad cheesy about that sales pitch, there is something quite compelling about the idea of our lives being both comfortable and easy, of living at that corner of comfort and easy. It's, dare I say, the American dream. Or maybe the promise of the suburban dream. Either way, we ended up buying the house. I look at that sign from time to time and I wonder of its naming origins. Our house was built in 1952, less than a decade after World War II, 20 years after the Great Depression rocked much of the country to a new low financially. Now, I'm not a city planner. I was a psychology major in college. And I do think there is something about those two words that were very much picked on purpose for the way it picks up on one of our most important desires as humans, the idea of safety. Comfort, ease, it sounds so good, right? And like the total opposite of what we imagine engaging in anti-racism, equity, and inclusion work will feel like. Yeah, pretty much. So while we're on the subject of metaphorical and real intersections, let's expand that to the sociological construct called intersectionality. Now, Kimberly Williams Crenshaw, she's a lawyer and a professor. She famously introduced the term intersectional feminism in 1989. She defines this as intersectionality is an analytical framework for understanding how aspects of a person's social and political identities combine to create different modes of discrimination and privilege. Examples of these aspects are gender, caste, sex, race, class, sexuality, disability, physical appearance, and height. Intersectionality identifies multiple factors of advantage and disadvantage. These intersecting and overlapping social identities may be both empowering and oppressing. So basically, intersectionality, it just widens our language for naming what part of our identities are used to increase or decrease our discrimination and privilege. So to put it very, very, very bluntly for you, white supremacy and the patriarchy have set up residency at the corner of comfort and easy. They have built all the other streets to serve this intersection. They have bulldozed roads that tried to touch theirs. Now, hear me very clearly when I say I'm not saying that life is always comfortable and easy for all white men. That's not the point of this. Of course it's not. But that is the goal of these systems. And often when life is comfortable or is easy, it's connected to one's whiteness or one's maleness. My Black women friends will often say as they process experiences of discomfort and ease, setbacks at work or other more extreme acts of discrimination, was that because I'm Black or because I am a woman? And so I think it's important this morning to remember that we can't keep the work of anti-racism only within the confines of race. Not really. It won't be fully understood or their voices, their experiences, their wisdom, their creativity. You can go to the next slide. So as a white woman, I have to take a minute and address the intersection that white women find ourselves at. If white men live at the corner of comfort and easy, white women live at the corner of comfort and hard. We share one street with the white men of the world and the other with women of color. None of us can choose our intersection, but we get to choose the street we live on. In her book, Hood Feminism, author Mickey Kendall writes, "Too often white men, when they feel uncomfortable, upset, or threatened, they can turn to the patriarchy for protection because they don't want to lose that protection, dubious as it is. They stand by when it's convenient and challenge it only when it directly threatens them. Yet they know they benefit from it being challenged and thus rely on others to do the heaviest lifting. See, the patriarchy negatively affects all women, yet time and time again, when white women have to choose between our womanhood or our whiteness, we often choose whiteness. It can feel like survival, choosing to align with the one at the table, leaving the biggest scraps for you. But it's really the loyalty and support that makes the destructive nature of the patriarchy that much more powerful to be a threat to all women. See, I want to choose hard street, the right kind of hard, like Glennon Doyle says, the kind of hard that makes the world better no matter what street you live on. If white women are serious about anti-racism, our deal and unspoken contract with the patriarchy, it must be broken for all our sakes. So start packing, fellow white ladies, it's time to move. Now, I know we're not in a room together, but I imagine some of you are thinking and wanting to shout out, but Jenny, I'm a good person. Why do I have to move or change anything in my life if I care about equity and inclusion? Let me be clear, I'm putting my money on the fact that you all are good people. But like my friend Austin Channing Brown would say, you might be a good person, but you can be a better one. So all this talk about diversity, what is so great about diversity anyway? I once worked with a team of about 10 to create experiential learnings and classes together. There were 3 Black women, 4 white women, 1 Asian woman, 1 Black man, and 1 white man. It was the most diverse team I had ever been a part of, and it provided an environment where we were all pushed to our most creative selves. I didn't, at the time, attribute that to our team's diversity or the Black woman's leadership we sat under, until I heard an interview with the staff of The Daily Show on organizational psychologist Adam Grant's podcast, Work Life with Adam Grant. When talking to the staff at The Daily Show, Adam noticed something was different. He noticed that the room was full of creative bursts. Psychologists actually have a term for that. It's called burstiness. Burstiness is like the best moments in improv jazz. Someone plays a note, someone else jumps in with a harmony, and pretty soon you have a collective sound that no one planned. Most groups never get to that point, but you know burstiness when you see it. At The Daily Show, the room just literally sounds like it's bursting with ideas. Diverse backgrounds and perspectives help with creative bursts, but we don't always realize it. When everyone in a group is the same race, they do worse at creative problem solving, but they think they do better because they're more comfortable. Diverse groups are more creative. It's not just because they have access to a wider range of ideas. They feel more uncomfortable, and that discomfort motivates them to do extra preparation and share new information. We might have felt more uncomfortable on that team, but like Grant said, that discomfort moved us to better. Better ideas and better outcomes and a better team, we form some real trust by pushing through the discomfort. When people ask me why diversity amongst teams is important, I point to this example. It's not just the right thing to do, it's the more creative, innovative, better outcomes, best thing to do. There is no way the best ideas can come when everyone around the table looks the same and feels super comfortable. There's no way. So I want to talk about feelings for a minute, feelings and our lizard brain. So I mentioned I was a psychology major, so I'm going to try to break this down for those of you that weren't. But I'd love to camp out on feelings for a minute. And while I have a degree in psychology, I am not an emotions expert, but I am calling it like I see it. And I really see it all the time. So white people, I want to talk to you for a minute. We can be way too in our feelings in these conversations in this work when we start. And I think I know why. I honestly think we're in a state of shock. Most of us have never consciously participated in the work, let alone the conversations of racism, privilege, supremacy, and the ways people that look like us and us have been complicit in these crimes against humanity. In basically an instant, the thread that has been holding what we know about our family, our ancestors, the history of our country, ourselves, that it's filled with lies and evil, I think our brain gets overwhelmed and it turns off. That is the rational part of our brain says, I'm overwhelmed and I'm gonna sit this next part out. Why don't you take over, lizard brain? I mean, amygdala. Now again, if we were in a room, you might shout out, Jenny, how dare you call part of my brain a lizard brain? But I didn't come up with this concept, so you can't blame me. I first heard about it from author and speaker and business leader, Seth Godin. Take it away, Seth. So Seth says, the lizard is a physical part of your brain, the prehistoric lump near the brainstem that is responsible for fear and rage and reproductive drive. The lizard brain cares what everyone else thinks because status in the tribe is essential to its survival. The amygdala isn't going away. Your lizard brain is here to stay. And your job is to figure out how to quiet it and ignore it. My therapist explained that our brain is kind of filled with these roads, and the more well-traveled a road is, the more our brain wants to walk it, and the easier it is each time we do. So I kind of imagine it turning from a road to a slip and slide. Whoosh, go our thoughts over and over again. Now, I don't get offended that we're basically calling our brains lazy, because now I know what to blame. Lazy lizard brain. When we encounter new things, our brain reacts and codes it. When it is coded as new or a change, that alerts the amygdala that it's likely going to get to go for a ride on the slip and slide. Now, Seth Godin says the easiest thing is to react, to go down that slip and slide. The second easiest thing is to respond, but the hardest thing is to initiate. See, we have to train our brains to react differently, to initiate new paths that take us down roads we never knew were possible. But that only really happens when we dare to swim against the current of what society has told you and me directly and indirectly about what exactly will protect us. So how does one start training the brain to resist the temptation of the slip and slide? We have to interrogate and distrust the narrative we have been handed and continue to be surrounded by. You know, maybe you have taken an unspoken vow of safety, of comfort, of fitting in. Maybe you have consciously or not vowed to make it, to be successful, to do whatever you need to do to get ahead. Maybe you have vowed that for your children, to do whatever you must to make their lives easier or more comfortable and secure than yours was growing up. Those are not inherently bad things. But like Brené Brown says, you can have courage or comfort. You can't have both. If you say you care about issues of injustice, made vows to it even, know that these two visions are battling like oil and water. They're incompatible and they cannot exist together. Pursuing justice is anything but comfortable, no matter how long one's been at it. And it requires a ton of courage. You have to start breaking some of those vows, and you have to embody the vows that remain. Jessica Dixon says, many people take on anti-racism as something to learn about. And that's partially true. Learning alone isn't the process. Education and knowing more isn't the end goal. Freedom and equity and full humanity are. Book clubs have dropped off. People have unfollowed the anti-racism educators they followed last summer. So what's missing? Embodiment of the work. When you're not actively embodying anti-racism, it is easier for it to take root. Our actions and who we are in the world flow from our embodiment. So what does that mean? Embodiment is not a mysterious process, but it does not happen overnight. So friends, it will not happen overnight, and yet it must start somewhere. Now, I am not here to tell you everything that you should do. I can't do that. You're going to have to figure that out for yourself. My hope is that you write your own vows, imagine a vision for the world, and figure out your unique part in it, your part in the creating of a better world and a better way. You will not know where each step leads, and that's okay. You start anyway. You look at what's right in front of you, your kids, your job, your family, your community, you. And as you look at yourself, pay attention to what you are drawn to, what you care about, what won't fade out or be a quick reaction. What is sustainable to help to keep you anchored in the work for the rest of your life? Because that's what it's going to take. Layla Saad calls these things your anchor. Start there, and the what to do's will come. Now, there are so many good and right questions to consider when you are faced with injustice, when you realize that you have a role to play. And I know we just talked about what to do, but we must move beyond that question to also make room for who do I need to follow? And who do I ultimately want to become? Because this is evidence of real, sustainable growth. Now, if you want to be the best possible version of yourself that you can be, that's going to include a vision and a commitment to anti-racism in your life. It just will. And isn't that a gracious byproduct of doing what's best for humanity, including what's best for white people? Though we should get something even greater in return, embracing and living out of our own humanity. See, there seems to be this myth that engaging in racial justice is similar to charity, like with clear roles of server and those being served. But the chains of oppression are wrapped so tightly around us all. White supremacy is coming for us all. It might just be coming for others first, but make no mistake that when the cancer of hate and intolerance spreads and wipes everyone else out, it will not care how little melanin you have as it crushes those who remain and those who lie in its way. This is happening in naked ways, like white people being killed at the Capitol on January 6th, just a few months ago, and in more subtle ways, like policies that keep guns more easily accessible, increasing mass shootings, domestic violence, and suicide rates, which particularly impact white men. The Department of Homeland Security declared white supremacists are the most persistent and lethal threat within our country. That impacts all of us, no matter what. I want to turn a little bit to a Mother Teresa quote. If you want to change the world, go home and love your family. Now, I think about this a lot as a white mom raising two white boys. When I became a parent, I started paying more attention to the phrase caught, not taught, implying that at the end of the day, our actions and behaviors are more of a teaching tool than outright teaching ever will be. It makes sense, especially in the context of pursuing racial justice as a family. It is not enough for the intentional and thought through teaching moments with our kids to be the only ones that are highlighting how we're pursuing racial justice. They must catch us pursuing racial justice. See, I have a little bit of a fear about this, that if you're a parent like me, we get to hide behind our actions and cross our fingers that our kids will pick up what or if we are throwing down, that we're a little sure of what to do exactly. So we do a pinch of this, a splash of that, and hope that it all comes together in the end. A friend told me about the time that his niece was inside a ball pit at one of those birthday party indoor playgrounds that used to be at Borders before Amazon took over everything, but I digress. All of a sudden, she started crying when a little black boy entered the ball pit with her. The girl's mom rushed over to see what was wrong, and eventually her daughter calmed down. But she later revealed that she was nervous that her daughter was afraid of the boy, since she hadn't been around too many kids of color. She was relieved when her daughter said something about the balls being too high around her. But that whole situation could have easily been about the boy. And maybe someday it will. Or maybe without some serious taught and caught, in many Sundays, it will result in this little white girl realizing that her screams and her tears are some of her most powerful weapons, targeted at whatever black body causes her discomfort. This is too important to leave to chance. It's way too important to not take every opportunity we possibly can to face it, to name it, to heal from it. I also believe that this is a work that has no limits. So here are some examples of ways we limit our work as parents. And if you are not a parent, I don't want you to tune out. Please keep listening, because I think there's ways that we all do this. So here's some examples. We are reading our children books about diversity when our own bookshelves are predominantly white, or when we only read authors of color on subjects like racism or oppression. We're advocating for the children's school to be more representative or diverse while avoiding the email or meeting with our HR team at work about hiring and retention of Black, Indigenous, people of color on staff. We're encouraging our children to be friends with any kids of color in their class, their team, their youth group, while your small group, your friend circle, your book club stays homogenous. Teaching your kids that everyone is equal while voting with your time, voice, money, and actual votes to provide, quote, the best, you name it, for your own family at the potential expense of others. If my child's school is the best, that means another child's school is the worst. Friends, it starts with us. We set the tone, the priority, the vision. We get to decide what type, if any, anti-racism legacy we leave for our children to inherit. Our kids are watching. Are they confused? Or are we partnering together to create a world that deals with the hard, uncomfortable, the painful, the complex? How will our kids know how to fix the problems of the world if they don't have a thorough understanding of what those problems are to begin with? Or feel the weight on their shoulders alone to solve them? And how will they believe we are taking them seriously when we limit our involvement to just what we tell them to do, not what they catch us doing in our own lives, our own circles, our own actions, whether they are there to be a witness or not? Because friends, once we start, we realize there is no limit to justice. You cannot control it. Once you begin to truly pursue it, she'll go wherever she likes, into every inch, pore, crevice, if you let her. Justice is limitless and transformative. Like a rushing water, she is not concerned with rules, but movement. So do yourself, your kids, and the world a favor. Don't try to contain her, boxing her in to where only where you are comfortable or passionate or knowledgeable or confident. Don't try to keep her safe, non-political, unifying, quiet. Don't let fear or old beliefs or family loyalty or people-pleasing hold you back. Let her run free, to free you, me, our kids, each other, us. And may your good, hard, and perfect work be rooted in love, with deep roots that bear the fruit of justice, equality, imagination, restoration, healing, life, and future. May there be joy in the resistance, magic in the collective, comfort for the disturbed, and a disruption for the comfortable. And may we all take up residency at a new intersection of courage and clear-eyed. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Jenny. Thank you so very much for explaining the importance of diversity within groups and how it actually makes the group better and leads to better outcomes. And thank you for creating an awareness around lizard brain. I certainly will be working on reducing mine. We are in the home stretch of our conference, and I'm excited to announce that we have a generous gift from my good friend, Pam McLean of InstaWriter for Hire, which is a full service creative collaboration specializing in art, custom framing, photo enlargements, restoration, and more. Our final giveaway is a $350 gift card for Pam's services, which includes a 1-hour art consultation. She will actually go in the home and recommend art, and a $150 value towards an art purchase for the home. This makes a great closing gift for a client too. Our winner is Ashley Najarian. Congratulations, Ashley. It has been such an informative morning, so I am very excited to announce our final speaker for the day, Bill Dedman. Bill is an award-winning investigative reporter who has spoken on fair housing and fair lending practices for years. The link to his most recent documentary contribution, Long Island Divided, was shared with all attendees several times prior to today's conference. So I hope you had a chance to watch it. Bill will share with us more of his findings, and he will offer some resources for those looking to generate change within the industry. Please help me welcome Bill Dedman.
Bill, I think you're muted. Bill, we can't hear you.
You're still muted, Bill.
Does that help? I am unmuted.
Hear you.
You can hear me now?
Yes.
I'm very sorry. My microphone button was on. Thank you, Jay. It is gratifying that so many real estate associations around the country have responded to our team's investigation at Newsday and are using it to provoke an important conversation. So thank you very much for this invitation. I'm hoping that together we can dive into looking at some of our Newsday video of agents in action, perhaps not on their best days. And I'd like to discuss with you a few of the implications of this investigation. It's called Long Island Divided. Maybe some fixes we can discuss for the problem of unequal treatment in real estate and the limits of those fixes. So my goal is that this session will be helpful to you, but also challenging. Something for you to think about and to take action on. So first, let's dive into how these tests were done and what were the findings. Long Island, let's start there, stretches east of New York City with almost 3 million people in two counties. It's a heavily segregated suburb, perhaps the most heavily segregated in the nation. And what we mean by that is that there's a lot of diversity overall, people from all races and nationalities, but especially African Americans are concentrated in very few communities. To be specific, out of more than 200 communities, a majority of the Black residents live in only 8. Now, we had long heard anecdotes from Black home buyers encountering problems trying to buy a home in white or integrated areas. And testing, we were aware, was commonly done by some state agencies and by fair housing groups. It's the only way to see how customers are treated. So here's what we did. Our Newsday team focused on home sales. We sent out first-time home buyers. We'd send a white home buyer and then an Asian home buyer, or white and Black, or white and Hispanic. The home buyers gave the same agent the same circumstances. So in our case, these were first-time home buyers. So selling another property was not involved. We chose testers of the same gender and roughly the same age. We dressed them in the same business casual style. I went shopping at Nordstrom for similar purses for the women. They asked for the same number of bedrooms, and they were prepared to give the same income and same credit scores, but rarely were asked for any financial information other than mortgage pre-approval status on which they were identical. We shopped for houses from entry level, and in New York City area prices, entry level is about $400,000, to the high end, $7 million. but always the same price range for both testers. And they saw the same agent. Now, how did we pick the agents? We didn't. The brokerages picked which agents would be tested, though they didn't know it. Whoever was on the board to handle walk-ins or phone calls, that was the agent who got tested. So we were following methods used by fair housing agencies with the addition of hidden cameras for video and audio. That's legal in New York, and it's legal in most states. There are about a dozen states that don't allow hidden audio recording. Everyone in a conversation has to know it's being recorded. By the way, I've seen national experts say that Michigan is often erroneously listed as one of those states. So consult a lawyer in your state. Still, testing can happen everywhere. Testers can take notes or can be debriefed afterwards. They can come back to our office and we can ask them what happened. We did these pairs or matched tests at 12 companies or 12 brands that together represent more than half of the sellers in our market: Coldwell Banker, Keller Williams, Century 21, Remax, as well as the large regional brands. Now, before giving you the numbers on our results, let me show you a little clip from our documentary. The problem highlighted in this clip is making inappropriate comments about race or ethnicity to customers, usually to the white customer.
Here, an agent gives conflicting advice about Freeport.
Now you have a bad school district, and that's not good for resale value.
All the school bus, see the moms that are hanging out on the corners.
But you don't want to go there. It's a mixed neighborhood. It's mini United Nations.
Okay. Because you might be more comfortable in a certain demographic area that is heavily one way or another in terms of the people. Bayshore has two school districts, Brentwood and Bayshore. You don't want to have Brentwood school districts. You want to have Bayshore school districts.
I can't say anything, but I encourage you. I want you to go to 10 o'clock at night if you want to buy diapers. Go to that 7-Eleven. They didn't buy there.
No, that's great.
I have to say it without saying it. You know, you have the knowledge of the areas.
Yes.
I don't want to use the word steal, but I try to educate. I use the word educated the areas. You know?
Hello? Yeah.
How are you, Russ?
Hey, Russ.
Doing?
Good. How are you?
We're either waiting for the owner or waiting for the agent to show up.
You don't want to be, I don't think you should be in Elmont. I think you should probably just be Franklin Square.
And I remember specifically, he talked about steering.
Yes, that's what he said. Steering, yes.
Yeah. And in the same breath, he mentioned, well, steering is bad. But this is what I'm going to do.
There's something called steering. No steering, you know, like steering.
Oh, like a car or something?
No,
oh.
Like a horse, you know.
Now the results. The agents gave unequal treatment in 40% of our tests, and the results varied in interesting ways. Asian buyers were treated differently from their white counterparts 19% of the time, 2 out of 10. Hispanic buyers were treated differently than their white counterparts 39% of the time, 4 out of 10. And Black buyers were treated differently than their white counterparts 49% of the time, so 5 out of 10. The question you have to ask yourself is, would the results be substantially the same or different if we repeated this test in your community or in any community in America? Most of the disparities were caused by steering. Agents directed 1 out of 4 of our minority home buyers into different communities, different school districts than their white counterparts. Along with that, there were agents who refused to serve customers, usually because of pre-approval. That is, both buyers had no pre-approval from a lender, but that was a barrier for only one. Now, let's talk about some strategies that can help ensure fair treatment. I have a sense from watching these tests occur that some agents have gotten the message that complying with the fair housing laws means not saying the wrong thing or not saying the wrong thing to the wrong person who might complain about it. Perhaps we need more attention on steering and differential treatment. In other words, on what agents do instead of what they say. Are we giving the same advice to all customers, treating all customers equally? Here's a video clip with a strong example of steering. One man and his family are warned off of living in an area, while another man and his family are told that it would be a good place to live.
Calvin Toon is a black man in his early 50s, and he went in to meet with an agent involving a test in the Brentwood community, a community that is 80% Hispanic and black. The agent communicated to Calvin, our black tester, that she enjoyed meeting with clients from the Brentwood area.
Every time I get a new listing in Brentwood or a new client, I get so excited because they're the nicest people.
When we sent Kelvin's counterpart in to meet with the same agent, the white tester was actually warned about Brentwood not being a nice place.
The nursing home we need to be near is in Brentwood.
Okay.
And so we found a couple that are in Brentwood.
Pretty close to each other.
Okay. And it just seemed like those would be handy also for going to
visit. Do you
want to
give me them and I'll look into them for you? Or?
Yeah, I can do that.
That warning came later to the white tester saying there was concern about gang activity going on in Brentwood. This agent wanted the white tester to know, but that information wasn't provided to Kelvin, the black tester. The listings centered black tester Kelvin in Brentwood with 27 house listings. While the white tester got zero listings in Brentwood and was directed towards much whiter neighborhoods.
One of the things that startled us was that agents time and again began their presentations to the buyers. These are new customers with inappropriate comments or information that violates the Fair Housing Act. It seemed, I have to say, that for these agents, steering was part of the service that they were selling. Agents would tout one school district over another or talk down districts as declining, but then give different information to the other buyer. Some agents have gotten the idea that they can't talk about schools at all. We heard agents say, oh, I can't mention schools. The Fair Housing Act doesn't say that. Agents can give straightforward, factual information or answer questions or refer clients to websites with information. The issue arises when the agents are picking and choosing different districts for different clients or making comments about the demographics in schools to steer someone away from a district, especially when they're not giving the same information to every customer. You know, NAR offers the following suggestions. The National Association of Realtors suggests that to avoid steering, agents provide customers with listings based only on their objective criteria, home size, other attributes, not on vague terms such as nice neighborhood or good schools or safe. And NAR encourages us to pay attention to unconscious bias. When evaluating what a customer wants, ask yourself why you may have eliminated certain areas. Now, I'm a layman, but I have a question. Why should real estate agents be eliminating areas? Why should we be picking and choosing communities for home buyers at all? Now, let's talk about what training and resources are available. NAR has responded vigorously to the Newsday investigation, and its efforts are interesting. The new program is called ACT, A-C-T, A for accountability, C for culture change, T for training. Let's talk about a little bit of that. A for accountability. First, NAR is working with state associations to point out where state licensing laws fail to support fair housing, where there's not tough enforcement. That is a new thing. The National Association making recommendations for tougher fair housing regulations and greater enforcement. NAR is also developing a voluntary program of self-testing, helping companies that want to test their own agents for compliance with their fair housing laws. You might think, well, there wouldn't be any such companies. At a hearing in New York, the CEO of Realogy, which owns the brand Century 21 and Coldwell Banker and Sotheby's International and others, said he's in favor of testing his own agents. And NAR says, we'll meet you halfway. It's working on a program, a sort of a cookbook, and making liaisons with fair housing groups to help test agents. That might be the most consequential change of all. If you want to stop speeding, you have more enforcement. So that's accountability. Under culture change, you know that fair housing is a core component of the Realtor's Code of Ethics. As you heard earlier today, that same code for decades required realtors to enforce racial segregation. So let's acknowledge that cultures can be changed and that change can take a long time. There's a long tradition in America of redlining, of blockbusting, of racial covenants on deeds, of predatory subprime lending that strips home equity out of minority neighborhoods. NAR says that a big element of this culture change involves schools, because schools are the biggest way that segregation happens in America. The steering we found was often done through steering to different school districts. Now, the common advice is that referring customers to websites that rank schools is okay. It's legal to do that. But you have to keep in mind also that referring customers based on test scores as an indicator of school quality is a way of perpetuating segregation, because test scores are closely aligned with income and education of the parents. Race is a good predictor of education and income of the parents in America. So race is a good predictor of those test scores. Test scores, write this on the blackboard 100 times, test scores don't tell you how good a school is. NAR understands this and is studying ways to looking for ways to give you more specific information to customers on schools and avoid this kind of fair housing pitfall. I think that's the area that will change the most in the next decade. Now, T stands for training. NAR has quickly improved its training materials after our investigation. To mention a couple of things, something new coming out this spring is that NAR is rolling out a course on implicit bias in real estate. How to recognize it, how to overcome it. It's a 3-hour course for brokers who can then teach the course to their own agents. And many of you have seen a new training tool that came out late last year. NAR launched a sort of game or simulation called Fairhaven. It's at fairhaven.realtor, where you can make choices and experience the pitfalls of fair housing. This is a very interesting idea. They're in effect trying to teach the law and empathy at the same time, so that agents can see the perspective of clients as fair housing laws relate to that. It's very well done. It takes about an hour to go through it. And I encourage all of you and everybody in your office to go through it. Now, all of that seems useful. Here's my layman's perspective in addition to that. If you give some customers the brochure on the school districts, you can give it to everyone. Time and again, we saw customers come back, one with a fat folder and one with a skinny folder from the same agent. If we have requirements of customers, we can apply them to everyone, require pre-approval from everyone or no one, ask credit scores of everyone or no one, ask income of all or none. Does your MLS or home search software, where you're signing up your customer to receive listings, does it encourage you to pick and choose neighborhoods or school districts for customers? Are you and your colleagues making the same choices for everyone? As a broker, I wonder if the broker who has the legal liability, and we have brokers in New York facing disciplinary action because of our study, as a broker, can you be confident that your agent is checking the same boxes and giving the same school districts to both clients? And how could you have any confidence that two different agents are doing that? It seems to me that part of the cure for that is, if a person is looking for a home up to this price with this number of bedrooms within so many minutes of a location for work or school, Why not send them all of that? Why not check all the boxes? It may be that the best way to stop illegal steering may be to stop steering customers at all. I trust that you all want to make sure that everyone who calls or emails or walks into your office is treated fairly. So what I hope you'll think about is what steps will make this happen. Treat it more like an engineering problem. It's not a very useful exercise to be trying to say who's the bigot in our office. No, steering is too common for just bad people to be doing it. I encourage you instead to think of it, if your roof was leaking, you'd be, well, how do we fix that? Why is it leaking? Treat it more like an engineering problem. I encourage all of you to watch our 40-minute video if you haven't already. It's all at newsday.com/divided. But also share that with your customers, share it with your friends on Facebook, and have a conversation with your colleagues. Not just, oh, that's bad, let's make sure not to do that, but how does it work in our office? And how might some differences slip through? And what supervision, if any, does our office have to see that customers are treated equally? That's where I hope that you'll apply some, not so much heat, but some light on that subject. I thank you very much for the invitation, and I understand that we're going to have some question time coming up soon. Thank you very much.
Well, I tell you what, thank you so much, Bill. That was very informative. Thank you for your contributions and what you have done. I have watched Long Island Divided, and I think it's a really gripping, actually life-changing piece. So I thank you for all of your contributions with that.
Thank you.
What a great day of learning, guys, that we've been in so far. We are grateful, as a matter of fact, to all the contributors and the sponsors who helped make this possible. Thank you again to the Women's Council of Realtors and the National Association of Realtors for making this event possible. And thank you to all the local businesses who offered items for our great giveaways that we've had today. We do appreciate you so very much. Now I want to ask our other esteemed speakers, all of the ones that are presented to you today, to turn their cameras on for me, if you would, please. We're going to open up our Q&A session. And I believe that we've collected some questions from the chat. We have some questions from the diversity committee. And if you all have on this call any questions at all, feel free to enter them in the chat and we'll try to get to as many as we possibly can as we go through this Q&A. So if all speakers are up and all cameras are on, I would say that our very first question will go to our wonderful Jamie. And the question comes from the diversity committee, and it is as follows. How do we address asking people's pronouns, when, how, and what is the best way to ask?
Well, that's a great question. So I think for sure, the best thing to do is to kind of go by how a person presents themselves. So if you see somebody like myself presenting themselves with long hair and makeup and, you know, obviously they're probably going to go by she, but that may not be the case. So if you're not sure, the best thing to do is either use their first name. Don't use Mr. or Mrs. You can use somebody's first name, or if you feel comfortable, you can say, my name is Jamie. I go by she and her. How should I address you, or how would you like to be addressed? And then they'll tell you. And if you make a mistake, it's okay. You know, we won't kill you, and we can just correct ourselves and then move on.
Very good. That important thing that you won't kill me. That is a great thing. All right. Jamie, thank you for your input. I've got another question here. Now, this one goes to Mr. Bill, and it goes like this. What happened on Long Island to initiate the investigation in the first place?
Newsday had long heard, even from its own staff and from Black residents of Long Island, how much trouble they had trying to buy a home in a white somewhat integrated area. So it's the awareness. This is talked about it in an anecdotal way. Let's find out how is this happening and how persuasive it is.
I see. All right.
Pervasive it is, I mean.
Very good. So we had some input that kind of led you guys down that path. And again, we're so glad you did. Because you answered that question so well, I've got another one for you, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Is this one. What happened to the testers after the investigations that you had? Were they actually looking for homes or what?
No. The testers were not looking for homes. You know, federal courts have pointed out that testers have rights under the Fair Housing Act. If you're discriminating against a tester, it's the same as discriminating against a real home buyer or a real person looking for a rental. They didn't sue. None of the testers filed any lawsuits. They could have, but they didn't. There has been disciplinary action against the agents. And one agent gave up in that process and surrendered her license, and many others and their brokers. So a total of about 100 people are facing disciplinary action from the state. And those hearings are slowly happening during this pandemic year. And, you know, they might face fines. Some could lose their licenses. We'll see. For us, that wasn't the point. The point was to focus on the company actions and to raise awareness. But, you know, having that person who gets stopped by the side of the road, the main point isn't to give them a ticket, is it? It's to get everybody else to slow down. So there's a deterrent value from some enforcement. So it probably will be important for that to happen.
Great. Thank you for that. Thank you so much. I guess we're going to involve Madam Carroll, if I could involve you with a question. Here's the question. What are some of the steps that we can take to undo the 100 years of systemic discrimination besides becoming aware? Is there anything else you could recommend to us?
Well, obviously awareness is huge. We have to look at people as human beings and individuals. You know, we all march to a different drummer, and what's wrong with that? It keeps life very interesting and diversified. And so obviously that boils down to those that have disabilities in my world, and, you know, whether they're visible or invisible, you don't understand what's going on in the mind of that individual. As Jamie so well put in her presentation, you don't know what kind of suffering different people may be going through. You don't know what their life was like just an hour before you met them. So we need to always be sensitive to other people's feelings. And as many other speakers addressed, you know, we have to not have a mindset that's already set. We have to be open and address everyone on a different level.
Understandably so. Thank you for the question. I got one more because you're the expert on the support animal pieces. So here's from a member. Justin is asking the question, for emotional support dogs, do municipal breed bans apply when purchasing a home?
That's an excellent question. Actually, federal law only protects service animals, and service animals, they do not have any language for emotional support dogs whatsoever. So the breed ban would and could exist against an emotional support animal, but it cannot exist against a service animal.
Great. Now that poses one question for me, and it's not on there, but I wanted to ask you something. When you're showing properties and say a buyer client has a buyer who has a support animal, can they go into a seller's property? Maybe if the seller said, we highly allergic to animals in our property or whatnot, what does an agent do if they are working with a person who has a service animal, but they're going into a private owner's home to actually show that? Is there something there that we need to know?
Yes, I think it's very important to understand if you have put your home on the market and you have opened it up to selling to the public, which again, Bill elegantly pointed out to us, we cannot discriminate or steer. It would be the same reference if we did that to someone that was disabled with a service animal. So do we want to certainly be respectful? We teach our recipients to be respectful if someone has severe allergies or something like that and you are in an unusual situation, then we do ask that you take respectful and appropriate actions, which might mean asking a family member to hold the dog outside for a few minutes. But that is not a requirement by law. If your home is open for public viewing, we cannot discriminate against a service dog team because they may well want to live there.
Ah, great question, because it has come up several times. All right, to our panelists, we're going to open up. Here's a question. Who'd want to take it? If you can't say decent neighborhood, what do you say as it relates to what defines a decent neighborhood or not? Who'd like to take it? Not all at once.
Oh, I'm not a realtor, but I don't think the problem is not saying decent neighborhood. I think it's how you're defining decent neighborhood. If you secretly mean decent means there's less brown people there, that's bad. If you're saying decent neighborhood has good schools, I think that's fine. I think, once again, it goes back to that same question. Why are the schools bad? Why is there lack of transportation? Why is there, you know, these sorts of things that speak to systemic and institutional racism? Decent isn't the word that we're concerned about. It's coded language. And what you mean personally, what you've internalized to mean by decent, I think many of those people, she specifically, if you look at the documentary, like, she specifically said gang activity and murders. Like, that's super like coded language. She didn't text the black people, "Here's gang activity and murder." She felt like those were his people. It really comes down to what you're defining. I don't think decent is scary. I think the bias.
Very good. Eric, I'll take that from you. And look, I'm going to go back to the group. I'm going to circle back on this systemic racism question. I'm going to extend it to everybody. And Jenny, we hadn't heard from you, so I'll share it one more time and see if you step up for me. What are some of the steps that we can take to undo 100 years of systemic discrimination besides just becoming aware of it? And Carol answered her piece, but I'm interested. What say you?
Yeah, well, absolutely. I think if we can't name the problems, how are we going to solve them? So I think it has to start with awareness. And then I think it also starts with you have to look back and understand how these systems started to figure out kind of what Eric was just speaking to, some of this coded language, to unpack it and to look at the systems that you're a part of, the schools that you're a part of, the communities you're a part of, and hold up every single decision through the lens of, is this perpetuating a racist system, or is this decision working in opposition to maintaining this system of oppression? So I think it's piece by piece, but unfortunately, it's literally everywhere around us. So wherever you are, you can be doing something to be dismantling some of these systems of oppression and racism.
Excellent. Thank you for that, because you did such a wonderful job. I have one more question for you. I know you can handle it. So here it goes. Why is woman spelled W-O-M-X-N?
Sure. So I think this is a way that I think people are trying to be more expansive as we talk about gender. It's actually kind of you can find arguments for it or against it. I'm a little bit neutral, but it's a way to try to be more expansive of, this is not just you were a woman assigned at birth womanhood that we're talking about. It's trying to be more inclusive in its language.
More inclusive in the language. Okay. I like that too. You guys are giving such good information with this. These questions just popping in. So here's one. It says, Eric is the one, but he stepped out, I think. Oh, he's back. But let me pose it. It says, to improve the terms of participation, can brokerages assist diverse realtors to farm in exclusive areas? Is that possible to do? And what would be the best or the safest productive tactic for racially diverse realtors to approach exclusive areas?
That question's for me.
Well, I mean, anyone can answer it if you want. What would be the best ways for you?
I'll make one statement and I'll defer it to the actual realtors. I'm not a realtor. I'm just an angry identity. So I think it really comes down to relationship building. I think the first thing you need to do is make a bunch of friends. I know it's easy to just have a network that is inside of your own realty, right? But when we bring people together, the question is, how intentional are you about connecting with other groups? Finding those folks and having those real conversations. The first thing you want to do is have to build some friendships so that you can discuss on that level. After that, I think it's when you start to plan to bridge things, to bridge open houses, because I think when you look at this conversation about what do you do about systemic racism, the only thing you can do is act, right? Like the only thing you can do is take action. Because there is no structure for this, you have to create some. And so I think the ones that you do, now that we have these real friendships and these real conversations and these real connections, how do we start to share these communities? Because honest to God, it's actually, I don't think people realize that it's actually scary to go into neighborhoods that don't look like you. I have a couple of Black realtor friends that go into those areas, but it's actually really like, I hope the police don't pull me over type stuff. So you do want to build a community where people feel like they are escorted sometimes.
Very good, very good. Well, I guess this time is flying by, but we have a last question. I think we have a last question. And I'll look on this list and ask, how would you recommend someone start their journey on becoming an ally or an advocate showing support for various causes and campaigns? What would you do?
I would love to answer that quickly. And then, of course, everyone else. I think one way for sure that realtors or real estate professionals can help is by joining one of the affinity groups, such as the Women's Council of Realtors, the National Association of LGBT Real Estate Professionals, Hispanic Real Estate Professionals, and SAREB. And so all the different affinity groups are out there for people to join and just to let the community know that, hey, and I'm actually a member of all of them. So I would say, you know, that lets people know, hey, this person is an ally or an advocate of our community. And if we don't let people know that we're here to help them, then how would they know?
Jamie, I have you. Bill, what do you have?
You know, I would add this idea of pushing back when clients are trying to push you into violating the Fair Housing Act. For example, I hear from agents about these broker love letters, you know, where you're writing, the buyer's writing a letter to the seller, oh, please pick us for your home. And an increasing number of seller's agents are refusing to hand those letters over. They're saying, you know, I'm not going to, if I get any such letters, I won't pass them on to the seller because they really invite the seller to commit a fair housing violation and choose the buyers who look like them, who have a family like theirs. You know, you're selling your house. Somebody might rip out the playset. That's just part of the deal. And I'm hearing from agents who say, look, you know, your roofer might tell you, I can't do that because there's a building code. We're used to doctors and nurses saying, I'm sorry, that wouldn't be safe. I can't do that. Real estate agents may need to increase the amount in which they just push back and say, well, I'm not able to tell you what the nice areas are because I don't know what nice is. I can tell you where there's been new things built in our community. I can give objective answers and you need to go do your own research. So part of this is pushing back, not letting the customer push you into violating the law.
Excellent point. Excellent point. Any other last minute thoughts from our esteemed group? You guys have been most gracious of your time and the information and the content has been overwhelmingly spot on. So we appreciate you for all of those pieces. The only thing I would add as a person who's in the thralls of this as well, the difference is made from the majority because the majority has the power and the control. When people keep looking at the minority to come up with answers that the majority needs to come up with, then that's where the disconnect in the problem is. The minority doesn't have the problem. The majority has the problem. So if it's ever going to be a correction on whatever is happening, the majority has to be involved to make a lasting difference in what that is. Yes, we play roles in helping them understand because they don't know, or they come from a different spectrum or whatever. But at the end of the day, it's going to rest on the majority who has the power and the control to make the biggest difference in what we do. We hope that we have shared some things with you all today on this call that have been meaningful, monumental, and positive changes that you might offer. Thank all of my colleagues on the call for your passion, your interest, your desire to make a difference, because it does really matter. What I'm going to do is say thank you all for being here today. Before I say goodbye, I want to make sure that you know that you have to go and complete the survey if you want CE credit for this conference. And I would be astounded if you did not want that. You must complete it by 10 p.m. tomorrow. We are sincerely grateful to each and every one of our speakers, to our sponsors, to our donors, and to you, the audience, as well, for your attention, your time, and your engagement that we have. Thank you all so very much for joining us. Now let us turn all of this knowledge into an action that makes a difference. God bless. Enjoy the rest of your week. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.